Should old acquaintance be forgot, and ever brought to mind? Should old acquaintance be forgot, and days of old lang syne? For old lang syne, my dear, for old lang syne.
It's funny because when I came to England from England 15 years ago, we were all sitting around the table, and my four-year-old daughter turned to my dad and said, "Grandpa Harold, I'm really disappointed with you." And we all laughed, but it was a nervous laugh because we knew there was an element of truth in it. And I think in our own way, we were all a little disappointed with Harold. He himself did not have it easy in terms of his upbringing, and he had a few difficulties which he never quite resolved. I remember going to the hospital with him when his mum was 80 years old, and I said to him, "You know, Dad, you don't have very long to resolve your relationship with your mum." And he said, "Me resolve it with her? She has to resolve it with me." And so in many ways, this is a type of burden that my dad walked around with, and he didn't really have the vocabulary or the skill to begin to resolve that. And of course, when I was a baby and then a toddler and then a young child, I had no idea of these issues as issues. I just knew what he was like as a human being. And it was only after many, many years that these issues then had a clearer focus.
Well, Uncle Harold, I think weighed about 10 pounds when he was born, very healthy. Except a month after he was born, he developed a rash, which turned out to be eczema. And the worst case of eczema that anybody ever had that I know of. It covers his entire body from head to toe. And if you know eczema, you're constantly scratching. And because you're scratching, you introduce infections. So much so that he's been hospitalized a number of times for it. I remember a policeman coming to the house one time and telling your grandma that your boy was dying, come to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
In those years, there were no antibiotics and no way of treating infections. So that he had a bilateral mastoiditis, which you don't see anymore, which is an infection of the mastoid behind these spaces behind the ear in that area.
Mm-hmm.
And he had an infection on top of his head, which had to be cut. He had various infections in his lower extremities. And I think he must have had an osteomyelitis, an infection of the bone, which contributed to a shortening of one of his legs.
Well, first of all, he was born very unwell, and before the age of 6 months old, he had 23 operations. One leg was shorter than the other, and he could never raise his left arm above his shoulder. And he was, the doctors told his mum that he probably would not survive, and if he did survive, he would be retarded. And all during his childhood, his mother kept reminding him that he should have been retarded. So he really, really had a lot of complex psychological burden, which he really was not skilled in the vocabulary of psychology to begin to deal with it.
My dad had something called erysipelas, which is something that we don't have anymore in these days. He was born on December 15th, 1922, and he had many operations all over his body. He was in the hospital more than he was home, and he was a very sickly child, and his mother never let him forget that. She made sure of that. She just, in her own way, just said, you know, Harold, or Heshy, whatever she called him, and you're just a sickly child, and it's never going to amount to anything, basically, is the way she raised him.
The grandma was a very hard-working woman. She worked in the store like 7 days a week. And she was up very, very early. And there was a synagogue directly across the street. And the old people used to come into the bakery like 7 o'clock early morning. And they were there, probably opened the store about 6 or 7 o'clock in the morning and worked until about 11 o'clock at night. And didn't have any time to themselves or vacations.
Right.
They closed the store like one time a year. That was on Passover. And then on Passover, they didn't even really vacation or anything because that was the time they would paint the store and refurbish and freshen it so that it would be ready right after the Passover holiday to start the year all over again.
And they started very meagerly, small business, and he built it up. And then he had the reputation after a while on Blake Avenue that people would come from miles around, from Long Island, from Yonkers, from New Jersey, because they had heard about the great products on Blake Avenue.
Well, why did you move to Glen Cove in the first place?
We moved there because my parents had heard of an available bakery, and that would have been the only bakery in town.
Right.
So they decided that without competition, and it was during the Depression, of course,
right,
that my father could earn a fairly good living considering the economic times.
We moved to Glen Cove out on the island. The high school was an old frame building, like a country house. And the classes were very small, probably about 20 in a class, not like in the city. And there were maybe one or two Jews in each class, not even that. I was probably the only Jewish kid in my class. But I didn't encounter any anti-Semitism, although Glen Cove population was the majority were Polish. And kids were taught in Sunday school that the Jews killed their Christ. So sometimes little kids hearing from the elderly prejudiced priest would say, gay and drell, gay and drell bak bagel. I don't know where they got that from, but they really weren't anti-Semitic. They didn't know what, they were just repeating what their elders said, I imagine.
Moved from Glen Cove to Brooklyn about 1934.
So why did you move back?
The business in Glen Cove took a turn for the worse, and most of the Jewish people who were my father's customers had moved further east on the island or back to New York City, and most of the Gentile people were not customers of that kind of product.
Right.
They didn't come in and buy rye bread and things like that. Father heard of another bakery on DeKalb Avenue and owned the one on Blake Avenue, and he decided he'll run the business, he'll run the bakery at DeKalb Avenue while my uncle will still manage the bakery on Blake Avenue until such time as they could foresee which business was, you know, more profitable, and perhaps they would retain one and close the other.
As far as I can recall, he's always been very bright. However, as a teenager, he ran around with the wrong crowd, I guess. And eventually went to CCNY when he finished high school, but never studied. And I remember he was taking a chemistry and was failing because he never studied, or perhaps cut classes, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
One day before his final exam, I pushed him to study his text. And as a result of studying just one day, got an A in the course.
Mm-hmm.
I say, very bright. But unfortunately, never utilized it.
Share it, my dear, covered with heaven above. Let's dream a dream of love for two, wrapped in the arms of sweet.
I had friends who liked to play cards, and they liked to go to the racetrack, and those are the friends that I happened to associate with here in Electchester. But when I was much younger, my interest in those things began through a cousin of mine named Albert Papier. The years that he lived with us, he was the one who taught me how to play cards, how to shoot dice, and how to shoot pool. And my brother used to frequently have to drag me out of the pool room, from the neighborhood pool room, because I was supposed to be home either working at behind the counter or doing my schoolwork. When I was in my senior year in high school, I got into with a crowd that hung around Greenwich Village, and we caroused a great deal and got home 2-3 in the morning, and I neglected my studies and lost interest in going to school because none of my friends at that time were college material or the interest in school, and I said, if I stick around with them, I'll have a good time, and who needs a profession? I always rely on my parents to support me, because that's what they've been doing all my life, and there's no reason for me to go out to work, and there's no reason for me to go to college, because I was born with a silver spoon in my mouth. This was my thinking when I was 16 years old. Unfortunately, I got in with the wrong crowd and never took advantage, as Rose would say, took advantage of the brains that I was born with, because it turned out that I got better grades in school than my brother David did, who later became a doctor. Well, he was an Orthodox Jew who believed in curfews and strictly confined my lifestyle to very rigid discipline.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't allowed to smoke, drink, or stay out late. Unfortunately, I was in a job where I was surrounded by 600 young girls in the Pentagon, and I was the lone civilian along with one soldier and one sailor. And I had everything to do to fend them off. And I mean the girls, not the soldier or the sailor. And I spent the 2 years or 2.5 years that I was in Washington going out every single night, but of course returning early enough to abide by my uncle's wishes.
Right.
And I dated girls from, I would say, practically every state of the Union. Tall, short, thin and fat.
Right.
It didn't really matter. Whoever came over to my desk at the end of the day and said she would like me to take her out, I obliged. So every dime that I earned at my job was spent on having a good time.
Right.
Female companionship.
Right.
My mother contacted a cousin of mine who we'll call Benny.
Right.
And he, at the time, was working for friends of his who he had grown up with. They were his employers, and he was working for a motor supply store. My cousin Bemi introduced me to his boss, who was also his friend,
mm-hmm.
and said, a cousin of mine would like to learn the business and work as a counterman.
Right.
And whatever you can do to help him, I would appreciate. They said, why, for you, Bemi, anything, and they hired me on the spot, knowing I had no experience at all in the industry.
Long ago and far away, I dreamed a dream one day. And now that dream is here beside me. Long the skies were overcast, but now the clouds have passed. You're here at last. The chills run up and down my spine. Aladdin's lamp is mine. The dream I dreamed was not denied me. Just one look and then I knew that all I longed for long ago was me.
I met Rosa Razzie. A few days later, I was walking down the street, 74th Street, with Herbie Cohn, who was an old friend of mine. And midway down the block, we passed two girls sitting on a bench. And as I glanced at them, it seemed that one of them was smiling at me. So we went about 10 feet beyond where they were sitting, and I said to Herbie Katz, I said, "Herb, I think one of the girls was flirting with me. Let's go back and see if we can pick them up." So I said, "Well, I have 25 cents with me. How much do you have?" He said, "40 cents. I said, "That's enough."
Mm-hmm.
Because the theater in those days was about 15 cents each.
Right.
See? And we walked back, and I said to Rose, who I didn't know, I mean, I had seen her before, but I didn't remember she was the same person. I said, "Is it possible you were smiling at me when we went by?" She said, "Oh, no, no, my friend just told me a joke and I was laughing." "Oh," I said. She said, "But I know you. You're that bakery fellow that works behind the counter in a bakery." I said, "That's right." She said, "I want you to meet my friend Sally," who was sitting next to her on the bench in front of her home, and I introduced Herbie to them. And we got into a conversation, just idle conversation, like, talked about the weather, and we talked about the war, and I explained to her that I had just been classified 4F because I had a problem with my leg and a punctured eardrum. And after about a half hour, Rose invited us upstairs to her home, where she said she would like us to listen to some Syrian music. Oh, I said, I had never heard that before. You know, I would be happy to listen to it.
Mm-hmm.
So the four of us went upstairs, and she put on some Syrian music, which was like Arabic music.
Right.
And then, I'm not sure whether her mother was home or her father. One of the two parents was home, and she introduced me. And then whoever she introduced me to had to leave, and then she put on some pop music. We were dancing to Audie Shaw and Glenn Miller and Benny Goodman, and she loved it. She said, "You know, you're one of the few fellas, you know, in our age group that I can follow in dancing." She said, "I love to dance with you. You dance beautifully."
Mm-hmm.
I said, "Oh, thank you." And we danced for about 15 minutes, and she offered us a drink, and then I suggested we go to a movie. During the movie, I put my arm around her. She didn't take it away, you know. She seemed very pleased about our relationship. Then we walked back to 74th Street, and I said to her, "I'll see you again. You know, I live around the corner." She said, "Please call me," and she gave me her phone number. However, what I did do when I came to visit her, or pick her up on a date, I always brought a bag full of cake and bread.
Mm-hmm.
Because I knew the family was more or less poverty stricken in those days. They had very little. As time went on, as I kept visiting her and dating her, I used to help the boys in their homework.
Harold was as good natured as they come. He had a loving, loving heart. He wanted to please so much. He was just so giving and so loving. And I remember this growing up. He used to take us, Natalie and I, to the animal nursery. He used to take us to the ASPCA, and we'd get a cat, and then we'd bring him home. My mother would have a fit and say, "You gotta get rid of the cat." He would take us to a pet shop. We'd get like half a dozen baby chicks. My mother would come home. My mother would have a fit. Got to get rid of him. So it was always, he was the good guy, my mother was the bad guy. It was always, he was always trying to please us. And he was just good and sweet. And I remember also he had like some far-fetched stories, like he would exaggerate the truth and make himself look good many times.
Rose was the one who hinted at the beginning that we should get married.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, "Well, you realize that I'm not earning very much. I'm depending on my parents. You know, the best I think I'll ever be would be a manager of an electrical supply and so on." She said, "I don't care about that. We both can work." She says, "I've been working since I'm 13 or 14, and I don't mind,
mm-hmm.
helping out and so on."
Mm-hmm.
So I said, "Suppose we do this. Let's get engaged,
mm-hmm.
and we'll wait. And we'll see how things work out in our jobs and see how our relationship works out to see if we're compatible." then and there we became engaged. It was, I would think, about November 1945, but we were engaged for about, I would say, 7 or 8 months. And we got married in July 1946 at the Hopkinson Manor, which is in East New York, or Brownsville, that area.
For the lips that I used to call mine, wonder if she ever tells him of me. I wonder who's kissing her now.
Both of them at a young age really wanted very much to leave their own parental environment and to move on, and so they were almost thrown together without really understanding the nature of marriage and relationships.
But your father was also a very kind person, would you say that?
Yes, he was a very kind person, and I remember his father before him also being very kind, and that's one trait I got from my dad which I'm very, very pleased about. And he also had another trait which he passed down to me, which I believe I still have from him, and that is he was never that emotional where he would get upset or he would worry about things. He would use his brain to circumvent the complexity of unpleasant emotions, and that is one of the traits I have had from my dad which I'm pleased about.
No, I have to say one of his weaknesses was that he would give in to us as kids, no matter what we wanted. If we wanted a cat, he would take us to the ASPCA, and we would bring a cat home with us.
Natalie, I said the same thing.
Oh, okay.
You didn't listen to my
No, I didn't listen. All right. Even to the point where he let us bring home 6 baby chicks.
It's the same.
Okay.
You better have some original stuff.
All right. So that's it. I had the same answer as all of you.
Come on, you can come up with something better.
What about the relationship between your parents?
Well, definitely Rose was in control. As we all know, she was a matriarch, and and Harold was like one of us.
One of us.
Yes. She would refer to him as her fourth child.
And from that point on, I went to work in the electrical supply business. And every job that I ever had, I always increased my position and my salary. And I was in Local 3 with various supply houses and electrical contractors for 37 years.
For it's hard, you will find, to be narrow of mind.
All right, well, let me describe my father a little better. Despite the fact that he was a baker for most of his adult life, my father was a romanticist, a dreamer, a poet, and loved to write songs, listen to music, and write poetry.
Mm.
And he dreamed of one day living in Israel with his wife. Unfortunately, the woman that he married was his, in my opinion, his complete opposite. She was very down to earth. She would disdain any remarks about travel, and she would constantly say, "Oh, Abe, you're always dreaming. Can't you be serious?" And my father was probably a lot like me, didn't take life as seriously as my brother Dave did.
Mm.
But he was a very good-natured man.
Mm.
And everybody respected him and loved him because he would lend a helping hand to anybody that approached him. He never, ever turned down anybody. My father's shortcomings. He was too gullible.
Uh-huh.
He was too gullible, and people took advantage of his good nature.
Right.
That was his shortcoming.
Okay.
And he should have seen right away that I wasn't going to be the success he told my mother that I would be. He should have seen that right away. That was his shortcoming. He looked at the bright side of everything. Don't bother them all the time. They don't have to all be professional people, but they'll be fine. They'll marry, they'll have children, they'll all be happy. I wasn't as close to my mother. I didn't feel as close to her as I did to my father. My father never put me down.
Mm-hmm.
My mother was more ambitious for us than he was. My mother, on the other hand, was very ambitious for everybody. Oh no, I won't allow him just to go to high school. He's got to go to college and become a professional person. That's why I'm working hard, and that's why you and I put in the years and the hours and so on that we've done for the children's sake.
This could be important too, because my father, and this is the Electric Industry Center, Harry Van Arsdale, my father knew, was the head of the electric industry. It was called Local 3, where my father was a member.
Yes.
And anyone who lived in Electchester had to belong to Local 3. And this has not changed, except for the there's a plaque with Van Arsdale. And I don't remember the black fence here, but the flag was always here. This was part of where we lived, the fourth housing, third building. It's changed. Oh my God, everyone's got such windows. And we're coming to the apartment.
Yes.
Where we grew up. Ah, Electchester.
So this is it.
This is it. This is where I grew up. It hasn't changed that much. I lived here from 1954 when I was a year old. My parents continued to live here. I mean, I moved out when I was in my 20s. And I remember one year I came back when I was about 24. It looks so much the same. It doesn't change that much. And we would get ice cream or ices, you know, those ices, we used to like that.
Italian ices.
Italian ices in the cup, and you turn it over and eat the good stuff on the bottom. And we were kids. We used to play stoop ball right here.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
This is it. That's the living room, right?
That's the kitchen. That's the living room. That's the bedroom. And that's my parents' bedroom right there.
Oh, okay.
And, I'll ring 2G and see if anyone's home, even though I don't know them.
What?
I'd love to see the apartment.
You want to do that?
Well, the problem's on many levels, and it's a very complex problem. But one way of viewing the problem is when a boy grows up to be a man, it's a very, very complex definition of self-identity, of what does it mean to be a man. And my dad, on no level, ever really began to address that problem. My dad sort of went from having a Jewish mother to a Jewish wife who then looked after him. And his definition of engaging the world and tackling the world and transmitting to me what it meant to be a man was something that I missed.
What about you and Rose?
We've had a very strained relationship for the first 25 years of our marriage because, as I told you before, I hadn't settled down.
Mm-hmm.
There were times when I went to the basement of this building and played cards and come up 2 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and leave her alone so I can go play cards with my friends. And she was unhappy about that. And then, of course, I went from job to job. I would hold the job for about a year.
Mm-hmm.
And if the boss said something to me that upset me, I would just get up and quit.
Mm-hmm.
And even though I had the responsibility of a wife and 3 children.
Right.
So that our marriage was not quite the same. And I was never a big breadwinner, so Rose was obliged to work all those years.
Mm-hmm.
And she's had a pretty hard life. She had a hard life when she was single because her family didn't have very much.
Mm-hmm.
And her father lost all his money during the Depression.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he didn't take a stand. I mean, he was a baby in many ways. And my mother was always the strong one. My mother... She put him down and he took it. So it was kind of like a very hard thing for me to take because growing up I could see my mother as a strong one and my father being a weakling and not respectful. And my mother wasn't respectful, so that was the kind of environment I grew up with. And it was hard to respect him when he was being put down.
No.
My name is Leon Arazi, and I was born May 11th, 1928. My relationship with Harold Papier, he was my sister's husband, he was my brother-in-law, and when I was a teenager, he always, he courted my sister, sent her birthday cards everywhere in Brooklyn, 2032 74th Street. Between 20th Avenue and 21st Avenue. And Harold's parents' bakery was around the corner on 20th Avenue. And he always brought 10, 12, 15 kind of cakes. At that time, well, when I grew up, I was going to high school. Harold was always there for me, helping me with my homework, answering a lot of my questions. And Harold with me was very talkative. My family loved him.
When I came over to Electchester to visit my uncle, you had a guitar, and you used to play the guitar.
Yes, I did.
And what kind of music did you play?
I played Never on Sunday.
Yes, I remember that.
Got the whole world in his hands. I gave my love a cherry. Lemon tree. Matilda,
Jamaica
money,
Farewell,
and Lunch okay. with the Sailor.
I entertained every weekend, and if I missed a weekend, Rose says, how come you're not coming to entertain? Come over, entertain us. Anyway, and Natalie would say, save me the seat.
That's right.
Right.
Okay.
I would say, save me the seat.
Because I had a crowd around me.
Stupid Cupid, you're a real. And I do remember as a child, like crying, and don't remember the reason. And my mother said, what are you crying for? You know, after she made me cry, whatever. She said, you know, what are you crying for? I'm going to give you something to cry about. So I was wondering at that tender age, however old I was, like, what does she mean she's going to give me something to cry about? I just didn't get it. You know, I thought maybe there's a little pill that, you know, I'm going to get.
But your father was always there to back you up?
Yeah, my mother would be angry at us if for some reason. She would say, Harold, you know, go punish them. Go. He says, okay, I'm going to take my belt, and I'm going to punish them, and I'm going to hit them. So it was a game, actually. So he would come in the room, and he would get his belt. He'd take his belt off, and he would, like, snap it. And then we would be laughing. We had some good times. And I also remember my dad, when I was really young, and again, I don't know how young I was, but I would get up early in the morning, and he would be shaving in the bathroom. I'd sit on the in the bathroom on the toilet seat and just ask him question after question. And, like, you know, he was, like, willing to answer me. I don't remember. I was always so curious. He cut himself a few times trying to answer me, but it was, I guess I felt bonded, you know, a great bond with my dad. It was a bowling tournament, I think, for Alan. And we got there and the place was closed or something. So I said, disappointment strikes again. And he loved that line, and I never let me forget it. He had gambling in his blood. Like, he would get excited at football games, and he had this different things that he liked to do, and my mother used to call it Fool's Paradise. And he would enter these contests from the Daily News and send everyone's name to try to win something. He never won anything, but it was exciting for him to try these different games. And my mother, I think she liked to take it away from him, you know, like, oh, what are you doing? You're wasting your time. She said that about a lot of things he did.
The nature of childhood is, I remember once when I was 7 years old, we were all sitting around at the dinner table, and something was said, and my father raised his eyebrow. And I was 7 years old, and I remember that 50 years later, that he just raised his eyebrow. And so many, many times over the years with my own children, I've said to them in much more dramatic situations, you'll remember this moment for the rest of your life. I remember one time when we visited his parents, and he used the wrong fork for his meal. He used a meat fork for a dairy dish, and he didn't realize it. His mum was quite upset, and she had to go out to the garden and bury the fork. I remember one time we did something naughty, and he would run after us, but of course he could never catch us because he had one leg shorter than the other. And because one of his arms was shorter, he could never reach his left shoe. So growing up, half the time I was asked to tie his left shoe for him because he wasn't able to reach it. But I have a lot of memories. He also had a punctured eardrum, so he would always sleep on his right ear because his left ear was punctured. And in that way, he would completely avoided any sound because both of his ears would not then hear because he had his good ear into the pillow. My mum tended to nag a bit in a fairly unattractive way, and the standard joke was, who are you going to live with when we get divorced? Are you coming to live with your mum or with your dad? Their marriage was never that really wonderful, and it's interesting because with the interview that I saw recently of my father, he was very open and very direct with the fact that he himself was not that mature in terms of being ready for marriage, and that my mum had to put up with a lot. And in many ways, you know, he was a really, really passive father. And that was really part of the problem with him and his marriage and our family life. He was just a very passive man.
When she got older, I realized that all the things she did say to me was for my benefit. And I felt sorry for having aggravated her all those years where I would be indifferent about school, or I'd run to the pool room instead of studying, or I'd be playing cards. And she said, "I'm very aggravated over you because you're not like your brother David at all. You're not serious-minded. You haven't got a serious thought in your head. I don't think at this rate you're going to become a professional person."
But later on, though.
But later on, she said, "Heshy, I realize now that you did whatever you could do, and you did the best you could do, you know, within yourself, within your means." And when she said that, then I said, "Mom, I'm glad you said that, because for a long, long time I didn't feel, you know, like the things you said, you meant it to help me. I thought you were saying it because you were selfish about how the other relatives and friends of yours would react to my not being successful. I thought you were saying these for your own benefit and being selfish. But I realize now you were saying it for mine." And from that point on, we got along well, and I did the best I could for her. I couldn't do as much as you. My brother David could. He'd bring over medication, and he would cut her nails, and he would see to her needs. He would do her laundry, and I didn't do any of those things. But I did come. I would read the Jewish paper to her because her eyesight was failing, and just sitting and talking about the family gave her joy. I would talk about how the my children were progressing, and we would talk about David's children, Jeanette's children, and she enjoyed my visits because it made her feel good to know that everybody was healthy and happy and successful.
Loving, very giving, and smart. I mean, he had a memory. He loved the old movies, and he used to, he would write off the top of his head from as early as 1939 up until 1994, the movies that won the Academy Awards for each year, just off the top of his head.
It's more errors of omission as opposed to errors of commission. In other words, it's things that he was not able to do. His sense of social graces was very backward. He was not able to meet people and speak with people and draw them out. He didn't really have any social skills, and I don't blame him. I absolutely do not blame him on any level, because it was unfortunate that he himself was just a victim of his own experience, and he was never on any level to rise above his own experience.
Well, my father, who's so good-natured, would do anything for my brother. And my brother, over the years, took advantage. He went off to England to live. And both my parents, like, my brother could do no wrong. He was their world. And my mother was, of course, very upset because my brother was so far away. And my father, my mother, they gave him money, they gave him my brother's education. He went to Stony Brook, then he decided to become an acupuncturist in England. And I also remember when my brother was growing up, and of course he had a share of problems, but my brother, Alan, was into playing ping pong table tennis, and he would go to tournaments, and my father would drive him wherever he wanted to go. It was Edison, New Jersey, and there was a tournament. Yeah, my father went. So, again, like, the children always came first.
Dad, you never read the small print for the job description for being a dad. You never knew that I studied your every moment to learn how to be a man. But instead, I had to learn it on the street, like an alley cat on a hot tin roof. You taught me to slice bananas into Rice Krispies and to catch midair flies with my left hand. You taught me to stay transfixed, like a bump on a log, by the small screen ad nauseam, and to disconnect from my rainbow feelings. You didn't need to teach me to cuss or spit, to hold my whiskey wearing hobnail boots, but you did need to teach me that the world is for tackling, the unspoken rules of social engagement, how to make little girls giggle and big girls swoon. But how could you teach me what you didn't know yourself? Did you never hear the collective groan when you stood up to read your poetry, then replacing Mum's name after she passed to rule the next in line? Did you really need to take comfort in casinos in your 80s? And video quiz shows for your leisure? You never outgrew your club character that you dragged along with your club foot. You made Woody Allen look like a man amongst munchkins. Dad, you were shy of a man, but, and wherever does this book come from? You never uttered a harsh word, and you wore your kindness like a badge of honor. And so, unbelievably, irrationally, inexplicably, you had my love.
Well, we were a close-knit family. We had each other. We had the grandparents. It was every Sunday. We would go to Grandma Araz's house. And Leo, my Uncle Leo and Uncle Dave would come over. So we had that close-knit family. And everyone seemed to get along fine. And we had good times and fun. He got along with everyone. I don't think there was anyone who would... He didn't have a nasty bone in his body.
It's quite remarkable, and I think there is a lesson for the younger generation to learn to be able to stay together for 50 years. I think it's quite a remarkable feat. And I remember very well when I was a lad, my mum said to me, wait, one day you'll have children, you'll see what it's like. And now, after all these years, I realize what she meant. What she meant is that when you're younger, children don't appreciate you. The children have to grow up and then have more experience of life than they appreciate. And so really, just between us, I'll tell you a little secret. I'll tell you the bottom line about Rose and Harold. They're really very kind people. And when we were young, we saw, you have to be a little bit older to appreciate that. And now that my sisters and I are a little bit older, we appreciate that very much.
And now the pièce de résistance. As they say in Spanish. I wrote a few poems which I'd like to recite on this happy occasion. And some of these are Rose's favorites, and I'm sure everybody will like as well as Rose. I could say goodbye. I could say goodbye to summer, to all the trees and flowers, to the mountain streams and rivers where I while away my hours. I could say goodbye to winter, to the wondrous snow-filled scenes, to the skiing and the snowball fights when we were young in our teens. I could say goodbye to the oceans, to waves pounding on the shore, to the fishing trips and sailing ships and all the adventures yet in store. I could say goodbye to the gentle rain, to the rainbow that follows, and the sky so blue. I could say goodbye to everything except my love for you. Now,
thank you. Thank you.
Your mother passed away when?
In October 1999.
And what happened to her?
Well, she had been sick with lymphoma for 20 years. And she had, I believe she had pneumonia, and then she didn't have the strength anymore to go on.
And what was the effect on your father?
Oh my God, he was broken. He was a broken man. He was depressed. He didn't think he could make it without her.
Hmm.
She was the strong one, and he was, even though she was sick for many years and he helped to take care of her, she was still the one that did everything in many ways, you know, paid the bills, took care of things. So he was really feeling lonely, extremely lonely.
Mm-hmm. And then did he recover at all?
Yeah, he recovered. It didn't take too long. It took him probably 3 to 6 months, and then he was out there and got back into the swing of things and meeting people, going out, dating. And he started to not be depressed anymore, and he had a lot of women that he asked out and would go out with him, especially since Harry was able to drive. And in Florida, if you're an eligible bachelor, able to drive, that is a great thing. Women are crazy about men who can drive.
And he went to a poetry group?
He belonged to a poetry group. He used to go to Barnes & Noble and read his poetry. And he also used to hang out. There was like a group around the pool. He used to recite his poetry. And he also belonged to a choral group. Well, I would say my father's eating habits were probably not the greatest ever. You know, he used to joke around and say, and he made fun of himself. He'd say, oh, well, I ate vegetables once. And that was a running joke with him. And but he loved his sweets and he loved his sugar. And eventually, I guess, everything caught up with him. And he had congestive heart failure. And around that time, there was a hurricane, Hurricane Wilma. We found out later on that he had been living like in the apartment without, you know, heat or running water. You didn't need heat in Florida, but he was living like in a disaster area for a while. And then we came in, and he ended up having to get out of the house. We had to fix it up, and I did. I became the power of attorney. And then my father had a girlfriend, and he moved in with her. And then he was sick, and he was tired, and he didn't want to get up and get out of bed. He had no energy left. Once he got sick, I would say he really like started to go downhill, and he was not the same. I mean, he really lost interest. And I don't know if it's the medication, but also once we had to take the car away from him because he was falling asleep at the wheel and driving in embankments and getting in. You know, he was in terrible shape. We had to take the car away from him, which was one of the hardest things. And my dad had trouble walking for a long time. He always had one leg shorter than the other, and he had a limp. So as he got older, it got worse and worse. But towards the end, like when he had the congestive heart failure, and he lost interest. I mean, he was no longer reading his poetry, but once in a while he'd recite a poem here and there. He'd still remember his poems.
I wanted to share some memories with you about my father, but when I started to remember my childhood, I thought, what could I say about Hesh? Well, Hesh was Hesh. If you knew him, you knew he was a lovable character. A courtor, as my mother used to call him. He was smart, too. Papa, my kids called him Papa, used to like to tease us when we were kids. He'd tell us he knew everything, and for a while he had us believing that he did. He knew every actor in every movie, including those that won the Academy Award for each year. He knew all the players, baseball, football, it didn't matter. Then there was my mother, Rose. May she rest in peace. I might not have always seen the love between them, but looking back, it was a love story. I didn't see it then, but I see it now. Rose was a disciplinarian, the matriarch of a family, and Harold, well, Harold, as you recall, would just never say no to us kids. Whether Alan was into bowling or playing ping pong, Papa would schlep us kids from Copaig to Jersey. Once, one of the last trips I remember when we drove all the way to Jersey to find out the bowling alley was closed, that's when, as the story goes, I came out with the immortal words, "Disappointment strikes again." Papa never let me forget that line. The closest Papa ever got to discipline was snapping his belt while we giggled. I guess what was important was the love you gave us kids. Not in words, that didn't come until later. But he was always there for us, and nothing came in the way of schlepping us kids and our friends to beach clubs, barbecues, or to amusement parks, Freedom Land, or Kitty City. I remember that Arlene and I didn't sleep for years without his bedtime story. And they were always interesting, from Leopold and Loeb to The Lady in Red. Nothing mattered because nothing kept Hesh down. He loved his family, he loved to dance, to sing, from Sinatra to Big Band, Jimmy Dorsey. He loved it all. Even the poetry, which came later, and especially his grandchildren, always precious cargo in their car. He had us envying the fact that he could turn his deaf ear to the pillow and shut everything out. The shorter arm came in handy too, kept him from home repairs. He never complained, though he was happy. An occasional game of pinochle was enough activity for him. Dinner was on the table every night. It didn't matter if it was dairy, Lachsenkugel, with ketchup, of course, or meat, Franks and burgers. He had simple taste, ketchup on spaghetti. He was the underachiever in the family. He had some rebel in him. Mom kept him in line, though, and despite a few minor slips, he followed the rules. No racetrack, and he turned his paycheck over to the family every week, keeping only 48 cents in his pocket at all times. Oh yes, and he drank coffee once in 1949. What more can I say about Hesh? He thrived. When they moved to Florida, he made friends, he joined activities, and even after having lost the love of his life, he enjoyed his celebrity as a renowned poet laureate of Sunrise. Even towards the end of his life, when he could no longer speak, he mouthed the words to his poem, "I Could Say Goodbye." Yes, of course it was too soon, but I found solace in knowing that he had a good life, that at last he'll be with Mom again, and Uncle Dave, and Aunt Jeanette, and Uncle Irving, his parents. I think Grandma Papier will be happy to see him, and all those who came before. Sleep tight, Papa. Keep your good ear to the pillow. We love you.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
this moment and I know exactly where my life will go. Seems that all I really was doing was waiting for love. No need to be afraid. No need to be afraid. It's real love. Yes, it's real love. Oh, it's real love. Yes, it's real love. Thought I'd been in love before, but in my heart I wanted more. Seems like all I really was doing was waiting for you. Don't need to be alone. No need to be alone. It's real love. Yes, it's real love. Oh, it's real love. Yes, it's real love. It's real love. Yes, it's real love. Oh, it's real love. Yes, it's real love. Oh, it's real love. Yes, it's real love. Oh, it's real love. Yes, it's real.